Bible, but do you have the Bible app done? Well, you just look it up on Google every time. You know? At least get the Bible app done. All right. Praise the Lord. We are reading in from the King James Version of Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. Amen. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, there henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin. Lord, now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And be seated in the presence of God. There's a whole in that scripture, and I'm not going to be able to get to nearly all of what it says there. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you, God, for this time on Palm Sunday and for this particular Palm Sunday message, God. Will you guide us, grace us, show us your way. Show us your way. Show us your word. Take me out the way that your spirit reign in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. The subject then is, what shall we say? What shall we say? I've told the story maybe a couple of times, but at a church I served at, there was an individual that would come to Bible study. He was a good person. But he got involved in drugs. Well known in the community for his athletic prowess one time in his life. He got sucked into drugs and has been dealing with drugs for many a year. But at the same time, he would be drawn to the church. Lord have mercy. He'd be drawn. He would be drawn to the church. And oftentimes, he would come and do some handiwork around the church. And we would help him, support him with that work. But sometimes when he would do some work around the church, he would give him some dollars, he would go out on a drug binge. If you gave it to him on Friday, watch out, all weekend long, he'd be out doing that thing. Just sucked into the drug life. And so he struggled with the drug life, the addiction, and at the same time, being around the church, in the church, and often coming to Bible study. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but that paradox that I'm in the church, but my lifestyle is nowhere near where God wants me to be. But still, I'm drawn to God. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, because maybe you're perfect. Maybe you don't sin in any way. Maybe you never make any mistakes. Maybe you never mess up in any way. Maybe somehow you've never been in an experience where you've been pulled into a life that is not pleasing even in your own mind, let alone God's mind. And at the same time, you're still drawn to God. You're still drawn to Him. You still want to know Him. You still try to love Him. You still try to care. But still, you feel drawn the other way too. That you move one way, but there's still evil on every hand. You try to get close to God, but still, you're drawn back into the same lifestyle. And you don't know what to do. It seems like wickedness is all around you. You're drawn back in, but you step back into the church. And so this paradox of sin or godly lifestyle, being called holy in God's sight, but feeling not holy at all, feeling a part of the church and loved by God, but also knowing you're a part of some craziness that's going on in the world. How do you deal with this paradox that continues to go on in your life? Some folk call you a hypocrite, but they don't understand the struggle. Some people call you want you to hang out with us, you with us most of the time. Why are you still drawn back there? And even those in the church who are not struggling with that particular sin are sometimes convicting of the one who's in and out and in and out and in and out, and they want to look down on the one who's in and out. When are you going to change your life? And you're like, I've been trying. But I can't seem to get it right. Can't seem to get it right. And so this was one of those kind of brothers. Good brother. When he wasn't addicted, when he wasn't strung out, he was a good brother. And still is a good brother, but still struggling. And so when we would study the word and we would get to this particular text, he would always bring it up. Because the question here is, what shall we say of sin? The question is, after 5 chapters in Romans of talking about the grace of God, the question that Romans chapter 6 is asking, well then what about this sin stuff then? If God is so filled with this grace, this unmerited favor of God that covers our mistakes and covers our errors and covers our sin, and now cross to pay the price for all of our sin. And so his unmerited favor covers us with a sanctifying grace, with a justifying grace, with a preeminent grace that continues to cover us in every way in our life. And even when I was in the church, he still was making a way for me. He still was covering me with his grace and his love and his mercy. And now since I've come to accept him as my Savior and my Lord, that his grace will continue to cover me, and that I do have eternal life. I do have everlasting life. I don't got to fight for it, God. I don't got to work for it, God. I don't have to do anything for it. It's a gift of God, freely given by God, to say if you want to accept the ticket of God's salvation, it's available to you. All you got to do is grab the ticket, and it's yours forever.
Yes.
Yeah.
Come on, teach now.
This grace. Sit in the Bible study. And what should we say of sin, Pastor? Because when he was asking the question, because he knew he was still doing a whole lot of sin, but is this grace thing really for real? Is grace still abounding in my life? I'm messing up. And I know I'm saved. I know I'm sanctified. I know God loves me, but I still mess it up, and people
can't believe it. Because see, look, I live in the world, you know, you know, everything you get, you got to take from somebody. Nobody does give you anything and does not expect to get something in return. Surely God expects to get something in return. So I don't understand this grace thing. And so the question, what shall we say to this? What should we say to this? What shall we say to this? What shall we say to this? Shall we go on sinning, as the NIV says, so that grace may increase? And he would say it with power when he would say it. Yeah, that's the question I want to know. Shall we keep on sinning? And he says, and the scripture says, God forbid. Y'all hear me, huh? And he would say, and we would say, so shall we go on sin? And I would say it again. He said, no, Pastor, God forbid. He said, wait, what are you telling me, Pastor? I'm telling you the grace is there for you. It's available to you. But grace is not going to be taken away as a punishment if you sin. See, this is the thing he had to get in his mind, that the grace that God had given him, that he had said, for by grace you are saved, not of yourself, not by works, but it is a gift of God. Ephesians 2:9, that we preached last week, that gift is still there, is still available, no matter how much you sin, no matter how much you mess up, no matter how much you fail, no matter how much you turn against God, you can walk out of this church and never come to God again, and God's grace will still be available to you if you've accepted him and you received him as your Savior and your Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And everlasting life is yours. You will go to heaven and you will be with God forever and a day. That's his promise to you.
Yes. Come on, teach
now. He keeps that promise no matter what you do. Because you decided to accept him one day. Lord have mercy. Oh, y'all better hear what I'm saying. So when we would get to this point, he would say, well, but does God then just let me go ahead and sin? He said, no, God doesn't want you to sin. God forbid. God not saying go on and sin. Don't get it wrong. God just makes it clear. You got some protections even when you fail. You are my child, and I'm not going to turn my child away. You are my beloved, and I'm not going to turn my beloved away. You are the righteousness of God, and I'm not going to turn you away. You're an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ, and I'm not going to turn you away. I'm not going to kick you out the door because you've been acting right. I'm not going to forget you. I'm not going to push you aside. I'm not going to kick you down. Let the world may kick you down. God's not going to kick you down. He said the doors of the church are always open, no matter what you've done, because God's grace is available to you. But I don't want you to keep on sinning. I don't want you to keep on sinning because when you got saved, I designed you to be dead to that. My grace is still coming. You have everlasting life, but I don't want you to keep sinning because it ain't good for you. Punishment if you sin. You're not going to lose your salvation. You're not going to lose your eternal life. No, that's not the issue. You're not going to lose any of that. You've got that forever and a day. But what I want you to know is if you keep sinning, you're going to hurt yourself. And see, that was my brother. He had to understand that. He said, look, brother, I'm telling you, if you all right with him, you don't lose your salvation. You always got a place in the Lamb's book of life. Don't worry about it. But sinning ain't good for you, man. It ain't good for you. It ain't helpful for you, man. You know, what you're doing that you're struggling with, you need to him, because sin is not good for you. It's not good. Somebody turn to you and say, sin ain't good for you. Turn to the other one and say, sin ain't good for you. Well, now here's the problem with sin. Here's the problem with sin. Sometimes sin is fun. Let me say that one more time.
Most times.
Oh Lord, have Jesus. Sometimes sin is fun. Lord, I can't believe the pastor said that. Come on, we're gonna tell the truth and shame the devil up in here. If it wasn't fun, you wouldn't be doing it. Come on, somebody. If you didn't have some part of it but being fun, you wouldn't do it. We all sing it somewhere, because sometimes it's a little bit fun. Boy, that mercy. You're not supposed to get revenge on somebody or backstab somebody, but sometimes you feel just a little good. Come on, somebody, help you. You got to know and deal with it so you can understand. You get a little bit ahead. That felt good. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. I mean, there's some sin that feels good. You know, you told some big lies. You told some whoppers about yourself, and everybody started treating you differently because you told some big lies about how much money you had, and you ain't got a dollar in your pocket. But you like the way everybody treated you because you had no money. You big man. Yeah, baby, I got $500. I'll take you on the town. You got a $100 bill wrapped around five ones, wrapping around a rubber band with a big old wad looking like it's some money, but it ain't no money. You got about $110, that's it, trying to wave around like it's $1,000, but it felt good to feel like I had it. Y'all better help me now. Come on now. Y'all, if sin didn't have a little bit of fun in it, you wouldn't do it. Lord have mercy. And I don't even talk about Friday night. If Friday or Saturday night with somebody wasn't a little bit of fun, you wouldn't be doing it. Lord have mercy. And so you got to recognize that there's an allure to sin, that there is some sin that just I like doing. But God's saying, short-term fun for long-term pain. Lord have mercy. Oh, in the short run, it's fun. But in the long run, it'll go and mess you up. In the short run, you know, when you used to get drunk all night long, it felt good. But early in the morning, when your head's gonna roll, Lord. Y'all shut up now. I get all this noise up in here. Y'all, ain't nobody making noise in here now. Shout. We just playing. Don't be playing around me. Lord, it was fun at 2 o'clock in the morning, but here comes 7, here comes 8, and your head is strong. And you're throwing up. You kneeling at the altar of the toilet. Come on, somebody help me, man. Oh God, help me, oh God, help me. Oh God, I'm a God, help me. Oh Lord, God, help me. Ooh, did more praying than you had been doing for the last couple of weeks. Because it was fun at 2 o'clock, but it wasn't fun at 8 or 9 in the morning. And so God says, I don't want you to sin, not because I'm trying to be a taskmaster, not because I'm trying to punish you, not because I'm trying to hurt you, not because I'm just a mean old God. No, that's why I'm trying to tell you my grace is covering you, because you are my child and I'm never going to take that from you. I love you and you will always be with me, but I don't want to see you baptized in the toilet at 8 o'clock in the morning, hurting yourself. I don't want to see there are consequences to sin, and I don't want to see you hurt yourself. So God says, no, I don't want you to keep doing this, because it hurts you. And I'm telling you my word and teaching you my word and getting you to understand my word because I want my word to live in you, because if my word lives in you, then I can take that desire away from you.
Yes.
So that you no longer have the desire to do those kinds of things in those kinds of ways, and that you don't live in sin and deal with the consequences of it. Oh, y'all better hear me. That's what my brother was struggling with. He said, brother, we tell the brother, look, man, we got to get you some help, man, because you can't keep doing this. But no, I got it, brother. I got it, pastor. I'll be all right. Brother, please hear me. You got to get some help, brother, because you are living in sin, and there are consequences to your actions and consequences to your body and consequences to